everybody to the session on mapping and digital project presentations. And I am delighted to have our three wonderful presentations. We are here to look at mapping, which is one of the most familiar and ubiquitous technologies in our day-to-day lives, but what are the educational implications of it? This session presents three case studies of using mapping in the liberal arts. And so Tom Morton is visiting assistant professor in growth and structure of cities here at Bryn Mawr, and he'll be presenting his course on the digital reconstruction and visualization of Roman urbanism in North Africa. Andy Anderson is academic technology specialist at Amherst College. John Karras, spatial analysis lab director at Smith. And Scott Gilman, postback spatial analysis fellow at Smith. They'll be presenting on a five colleges course that resulted in the creation of service-oriented, communally beneficial geographic information science and technology websites and maps. And Annette Berchi is associate professor of Greek, Latin, and classical studies and director of the graduate group here at Bryn Mawr. And she will be discussing her work with students in creating an Omeka exhibition about food in the ancient world. So Tom will kick us off, and what we'll do is, after each presentation, we'll take one or two kind of burning questions, and then we'll leave the full discussion session for the end so that we can look for synergies among the presentations.
Good afternoon. Dina, thank you for your kind introduction. In the fields of art and architectural history, as well as archaeology, speakers read from prepared texts for their conference presentations. However, it's been my experience that technology talks tend not to be scripted. Apropos of a blended learning conference, I have scripted my introduction and will speak from notes for the rest of the presentation. During the latter part of the 2009 spring semester, I was a faculty member in the architecture program in the design school at Arizona State University. I was having a hallway conversation with Darren Petrucci, then the director of the design school, and we were discussing my upcoming courses for the next school year. Darren stated explicitly that he wanted me to teach a seminar that fully integrated my research on the architecture and urbanism of ancient Roman North Africa into the classroom setting. I quickly responded by saying that, wow, that would be great. Our students do not have the language skills to read the Vital Scholarship in German, French, and Italian. Darren wonderfully and bluntly responded, just to figure it out. I was rendered speechless and walked away. Just figure it out. Truth be told, I cursed Darren for the next 2 days. I kept asking myself, how can one study Roman Carthage if you can't read Friedrich von Hoff's excavation reports in German? Even his maps are hard to read. How can you understand Spätzle if you do not read Berlin or Bejawe's articles in French? Lots of buildings, but lots of text. How can we study Lepus Magna if you do not read Davidson's essays in Italian? Then, in a moment of clarity, I ask myself, what happens if I focus on what the students can do and not on what they cannot do? I was in an architecture program. The students were incredibly creative. They were designers, and they had amazing computer skills, of which I was insanely jealous. So I asked myself, what happens if we totally change the research model, and in this case, the classroom model? What happens if the students construct these Roman cities in 3D visualization programs, and I act as the research library for the students? What happens if we allow the students' design sensibilities to be foregrounded in their investigations? Scholarly research would obviously still be vital, so what happens if, instead of working individually, the design students were paired with students in other majors, more compared together, such as art history or poli-sci, classics, etc. Lastly, if the students worked in teams, one compared together undergraduates and graduates, at graduate students, and this could possibly ensure that all class projects would be strong. Taken collectively, the students would work in collaborative teams and build Roman cities on their computer screens and try to answer the deceptively simple question, what determined the architectural and urban forms in these Roman cities in North Africa? All of this sounds pretty cool and quite scary. For starters, I am lucky if I can spell the names of the 3D visualization software packages, let alone use them. In addition, I was very much aware of the Rome Reborn project at UCLA, seen here, and knew that it had taken it years and hundreds of thousands of dollars to construct this stunning 3D visualization of ancient Rome. I would have 15 weeks during the semester with the students and no money. With equal parts of boldness and hubris, I created a course entitled Digital Rome and initially taught it during the spring 2010 term. This presentation will address the creation of this course and the teaching of this course across three different academic institutions, one large public university, Arizona State, and two small private liberal arts colleges, Swarthmore College and Bryn Mawr College. What I hope becomes clear is that one institution or even one type of institution is not necessarily better than another. Rather, the success of this course is dependent upon three things. Creatively leveraging the strengths of an institution, maximizing the students' diverse talents, abilities, and skill sets, and luck. In addition, I will also demonstrate how this course, Digital Rome, has profoundly impacted my scholarship. The structure of the remaining part of the talk will give you a brief overview of ancient Rome, Roman North Africa, talk about how I used digital models, and then go through a series of case studies from the student work at Arizona State, then on Swarthmore, and then finally here at Bryn Mawr, and then I will make some concluding remarks. So first things first, the Roman Empire. What you see in orange was the greatest extent of the Roman Empire. Roman Empire was in existence for approximately 500 years, approximately 2,000 years ago, and if you were to put a modern map over this, parts of 35 modern countries were once part of the Roman Empire. Cultural diversity has been around for millennia, and it's great to actually engage students with that when dealing with ancient Rome. Now, within all of this, you have all of this great section over here in North Africa. North Africa had approximately 675 Roman municipal entities that are known through archaeology, epigraphy, as well as ancient texts. Think about it, 675, that's a lot. There's absolutely no way we can address all of that. We obviously will only look at case studies. And for me, it's part of a larger theme, looking at what I call the individuality within regularity. I came up with this phrase while initially looking at condominium complexes in the Greater Phoenix area, but I was like, it works for Roman too, Roman material too. And I would also say, with this map, we also put in the modern countries. Let's not forget the current political situation in North Africa, okay? Some people, casually ask, will you do a study abroad trip? And I'm like, not where I work. And this was very much, this point was driven home earlier this term, because if you recall back in mid-February, there was this report of the U.S. Struck an ISIS compound near Sabratha. I had a team of students working on the ancient city of Sabratha this past term. And so, we talked in class, what you're doing, with these reconstructions, it's pretty important because it's going well beyond just a classroom setting. This is actually helping us think about stuff that could be lost. And I would also say, due to the fact that there are 675 cities, we can ask a larger question, how do we teach innovative architecture and urbanism in this creative part? One of the ways to think about doing that is to use a series of case studies, and I'll also allow students to, instead of going across, to go deep, and to choose a city, and spend the entire semester working on it. Okay, and that's what I decided to do. Now, it's also important, before we get too far into this, to also talk about what this is not. Assassin's Creed, yes. I gave an invited paper at the American Academy in Rome a couple of years ago. Three out of the four speakers are offering digital reconstructions. Mine were black and white and gray. This other scholar, primarily black and white as well. And then the third scholar, full of color. And he's like, we have to address all the students who are using video games. And I said, but our scholarship might have a different audience. And so, yes, the Pantheon looks great in Assassin's Creed, but that's maybe we have a different audience. And so how we visually represent something could be different. If we have different goals, our visual representations could be quite different. And so what do we do? And I would say if you only take away one image from my entire presentation, let it be this one. For us, when we create digital images, we do this principally in a program called SketchUp, although students can use other computer programs if they wish. When I was teaching at Arizona State, I had students do things in AutoCAD as well as in Revit. But we use the historical sources, we use the archaeological data, the comparative data, and creative thinking to create the digital images. Now notice, it's not archaeological data plus historical sources plus comparative data plus creative thinking equals the digital image. The arrows go both ways. Once we have the digital model, it then forces us to ask better questions of the archaeological material, the textual material, the comparative material. And so the actual digital models are, if you will, a research tool. They're part of that research process. Creating the images, in essence, it's not the end game. Now, I've taught this across three institutions, and I just wish to acknowledge the students. Take them all in. They get a ton of credit. The ones with the asterisk, those students also served as research assistants after the course. This entire column right here, these were students this past term when I taught the course here at Bryn Mawr. So I had 14 students, easily the largest number of students in a course whenever I taught it, and we'll get to some of the work later on. But for today, I've chosen, like I said, a couple of examples. We'll be looking at the city of Spetla, right here. We'll be looking at Sabratha. We'll be also looking at Lefkas. If we have time, I will also bring in Carthage to show how this has also impacted my own work. Here's the view of Spetla. You might say, great, so much is standing. Why do we need a digital model? Well, number one, these are reconstructed buildings, and we can't assume that they're correct. And number two, there's a lot of stuff that's missing. And in the process of students being, after they sign up for the class, I mentioned that this is a collaborative project. I need them to fill out a skills sheet. Let me know what your language skills are. Let me know what your computer skills are. What are your thinking skills? What other things do I need to know about you? Like somebody says, I'm a perfectionist. Somebody might say, I'm a take charge type of person. Mm-hmm. These are great things to know, and they will have a profound impact on who I'll actually put together, because I'm the person who actually forms the teams, not the students. And it also enables me to put together maybe a sophomore with a senior, or when I was at Arizona State, an undergrad with a grad. I then give the students a list of cities. I show them a series of images of the cities they choose. And then I also give them a 30-page bibliography and say, start. And I say, there's plenty more out there. And so they will start their work. And then they start, and during the length of the semester, they will create three presentations. One, usually right before spring break, okay? And then two, in the second half of the semester. This gives them time to, in essence, learn. When I was at Arizona State, I was based in an architecture program. The students had computer skills, so I didn't have to even think about teaching computer skills. And if they're working as teams, then different teammates could bring together their different talents. A classic example, the first presentation I'll show for Spinklin, the one student was an architecture student, the other was poli-sci. When I asked about computer skills, he said, Microsoft Word on a good day. I could relate. But he had an outstanding understanding of history. Okay? And so it was a wonderful pairing. That student also really got into the research, and he asked the fabulous question. How do you draw baby? If we're doing digital reconstructions, well, we're almost making the assumption that, you know, the evidence is there, we can put the buildings up. What happens when the evidence isn't there? What happens when different scholars have different interpretations? What do you do? How do you represent the material? And these are questions that the students grappled with. And so when Alex and Justin were working on this on Spatla, they were very interested in the relation of those three temples. They put them all together, but then in relation to this arch, all these lines, well, part of what they were trying to show is the actual honorific arch is off center in relation to the actual temples themselves. Exclamation point, question mark, why? And so they went about trying to figure that out. And so here you can actually see how they're trying to use the graphics as well as, you know, make something stand without actually using text. And so you have students really working, trying to figure out how they can actually show all of this. Looking at, Hadrian's Baths, which is in Lacus. I was in Arizona State. Students are interested in, you know, the climate. So this group with Jasmine and they were actually looking at the orientation of buildings in antiquity to see if that actually impacted, it's on this angle such that these rooms, which had hot water and hot air, they're actually oriented to the south. Yep, and it's right there on the buildings. And so they create their digital models trying to show this. When I moved to Swarthmore, I was immediately informed about these grants. There is a what was called a speed grant for educational exploration and development. And I was like, great, let me do this. And so I applied for it and I got it. I was also informed of a TRICO digital humanities grant. I applied for it and got it as well. The interesting thing was, here was a course that received lots of financial support, tech support, human support, and we only had three students in the class. And one was a Bryn Mawr student at Seong. And so when the students worked on it, the support enabled us to actually have the models, digital models in advance for the students, such that they could simply put their buildings in, knowing that they would not have the digital skills. As such, it was like, okay, we can put in these larger projects. Seong wanted to work with this zone to say, here's sea level, the forum, it's 55 meters higher. How do you get there? And so here's trying to answer a very straightforward question. How do you get from point A to point B? But it's not simple. And so she actually worked out a whole series of case studies to say where you would actually put the stairs and why, which is a really cool thing. And then looking at it both from the sea up to the top and then being at the top looking out towards the sea. And so it was an interesting experience teaching it at Swarthmore, but like I said, it was only with three students. And so it was very hard to step back and do an assessment of it. Then I got a position here at Bryn Mawr in the Growth and Structure of Cities Department, which you might imagine is somewhat ideal for a course like this. And here at Bryn Mawr, there's also a History of Art Department, a Greek, Latin, Classical Studies Department, a Classical and Near Eastern Archaeology Department, And so there was a body of students who would be interested in this. In addition, there's also this digital lab, literally right over there, with collaborative workstations. So this here's a computer room, a room set up perfectly for this course. Okay? And so I said to Dell, the gentleman who works there, I said, we will be in this all the time. And he was like, okay. I brought in two projects. One, this is by Mackenzie Chillip, Alexandra Mary. She's looking at their early projects. They were interested in trying to show this building. I'm like, you're missing some of the architecture. And they're like, okay, note to self. Put that in for the next time. And they were trying to answer some very difficult questions. And this is the thing about this course. Students choose often very difficult questions that they're trying to answer through the digital model. They were looking at multiculturalism. How do you actually see this? What about bilingual inscriptions? Mm-hmm. Yeah, you see it. For when I was a sophomore, I assumed, what about social justice? What about class? Can we actually see it? Yes. How does it play out in architecture? And he actually digitally modeled it. They are also interested in the use of water. Okay? And let's make sure we put the people in so we get a sense of scale for this massive project. And we see that, yeah. Pretty large bath complex. Their classmates were also quite interested in the later stages. And so here, their presentation 3, they did the actual Severan phase of the city. Details here. The classmates also worked on Sabratha. And you can see Hepford College and Bryn Mawr. The city's major is by college. And so nearly half the students came from Haverford. And they were like, yes, we have a rivalry between Sabratha and Lefkas. It takes 39 hours to walk, but yeah, it's there. And this is what they start, this is the part of their model. And so this is the beauty of this. This is all being done in like 14 weeks. And for many of the students, they've never touched this computer program before. Okay? And so they're trying to answer, why is this in one orientation versus this one? What about your paths of access, lining it up with the actual archaeological remains? And saying, what about the distance out from the edge? Saying, if you are approaching from a rival city, and you stand for this image 854 meters away, you can see the towering theater, which is the largest in all of North Africa, and even the temples off in a distance. It is about show, and you have it right there. My time is up. I will happily answer questions later on, or right now, or even later on, about the students actually doing this, as well as how this really has impacted life and scholarship.
Let's do one burning question now, and then we'll have time at the end.
All perfectly good.
Okay. What was the actual modeling software that you
used? SketchUp. Yeah. And it's a free software for students. If you actually need it for a computer labs, it's like $15 a computer station, which is in relation to a textbook, quite cheap. Yes.
To assess the work.
Assess the work is, number one, I would say depths of ideas. Okay. And I would say, if you think about if I have students writing papers, what's the depth of what's a great phrase, multiplicity of depth that you're looking for in a paper? Can I talk about the depth of ideas? Can I see a sense of it, the depth of ideas and their investigation? Yes. I also, while they're also doing presentations, we're also having regular in-class conversations. And so the actual participation in class, are they moving conversation forward? Okay. And then also, this was 14 students. As the semester went forward, the students were realizing how interconnected all their cities were. And saying, so your Severan arch is like this, but my Severan arch is like this. And I can hypothesize why mine is looking like this versus what you have over there. And we haven't even started to talk about topography, And so they would go off in different directions. And so, yeah. All right, thank you.